Good morning on this late start day on the 10th of February 2014. Today's lecture is unfortunately being brought to you remotely rather than live in person because PSU has decided to have a late start today. One quick announcement, and that is that, again, since we didn't have a lecture on Friday, the subject matter in this lecture and in Wednesday's lecture, when we will hopefully be there, will be a combination of the two lectures that we were going to have. Hopefully most of this is review in terms of genetics. I did have a couple of comments on some questions on the exam that also has been posted on both D2L and our YouTube feed. Unfortunately, today we have no clicker questions because I don't know how to do that online, at least not quite yet, so think yourselves lucky. There will be clicker questions on Wednesday based on this material. Quick review so that you guys are still up to speed. For double-stranded break repair, last time we really mostly talked about homologous recombination, and homologous recombination not just for double-stranded break repair, but also for meiotic recombination that we may end up getting to today, a little bit about that process of recombination. I know that's really important for gene mapping. Just a little bit about translesion synthesis. These are those error-prone DNA polymerases which are turned on in the SOS response in E. coli, but also when there's major DNA damage that happens in eukaryotic cells as well. Just a little bit about viruses. Again, if you want to know more about viruses, you need to take my course next term. And those particular aspects of viruses that we talked about were really the virus life cycles, how they replicate, lytic, lysogenic, or more of a chronic infection. Of course, those chronic infections are mostly what you see in eukaryotic viruses. Talked a little bit about plaque assays, and these are ways to determine the number of viruses you have. What I forgot to mention last time is that these plaque assays are really important because it's very hard to see viruses. You really need an electron microscope to see all except the very, very largest of the viruses. So generally what people use are these plaque assays or some modification thereof to actually count the number of viruses that you have, or infectious virus particles. Spent most of the time talking about bacteriophage T4, and probably the most fascinating part about bacteriophage T4 is that its genome has the modification of hydroxymethyl cytosines instead of cytosines in its genome, and also that the ends of the genome are terminally redundant, and when you look at a population of bacteriophage T4, that gives you a circularly permuted genome, and that's why the genome map is circular, even though the genome itself is linear. FIX-174 has overlapping open reading frames and is a single-stranded circular genome and replicates by rolling circle, and MS2 is the first of the RNA viruses that we talked about, and of course RNA viruses need to have an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase in order to be able to replicate. Today looks like a ridiculously long list of what we're going to be talking about in terms of genetics, but again, hopefully this is either review from what you have already learned or hopefully remember from principles of biology, but also what you are either learning right now in genetics or will be learning when you take genetics a little bit later on. We'll start out a little bit talking about some of the various mutants which you can find, really difference between mutant and wild type, and the sort of basis of genetics is looking at mutants and how you go about looking at mutants. Talk a little bit about dominant and recessive in terms of really the molecular aspects of genetics. A little bit about complementation and allele segregation. Some conditional mutants and mapping. All of this stuff, which is on the left-hand side of the slide here, is really sort of classical genetics, and again, is hopefully review. We'll talk a little bit more about molecular genetics, and that's really what's here on the right-hand side. This will be the, sort of the second half of today's lecture. A little bit about genetic engineering, which most people think of in terms of molecular cloning. And when I say molecular cloning, I basically just mean making many, many copies of one particular gene or one particular part of genetic material. One kind of genetic material to work with are the so-called cDNAs or complementary DNAs. These are DNAs which are copies of messenger RNAs. We'll talk a little bit about genomic libraries, and this is how you can go about looking at some of these particular cDNAs, the mechanism of PCR, which is really critical in terms of not just doing molecular cloning, but really all kinds of diagnostics and forensics, etc. DNA sequencing, we'll talk a little bit about this, and then if we get to it, we'll talk about blots, microarrays, and reporter genes. If we don't get to these things today, we will talk about them on Wednesday. Let's first start out again, sort of the fundamental aspects of what is genetics and what is a so-called mutant. And the real differentiation here is between the mutant and wild type. And these happen to do with really, what's the most common kind of one particular gene in one particular organism. That's wild type. And not surprisingly, it's usually also the functional version of a particular gene. The non-functional version, or often a recent one, and usually this is one which has been made or recently isolated, is then the mutant allele of a particular gene. Of course, this all depends on allele. An allele is just really one form, and as we know, genes are really all about sequences, of a particular gene. So you can have a wild type allele, you can have a mutant allele, and in fact, you can have multiple different mutant alleles. And some people talk about alleles as sort of sequence variants or variants of any particular gene. I'll probably use those interchangeably, but the best term to use is actually this allele term. Few more definitions, and this is probably, if anything, the most critical aspect of this lecture has to do with these various different definitions. First, phenotype. What can you see? And really, as I have the note down here at the bottom of the slide, genetics is the study of phenotypes. If you don't have a phenotype, you can't do genetics. You can't see a difference between your mutant and your wild type, then you can't do genetics. Now, the underlying part of that, of course, is what's the genotype? So, what's your genetic makeup of any individual? And that genotype could be of a wild type, or it could be the genotype of a mutant. Now, doesn't matter. Again, the genotype is going to be the genotype, but if the genotype is what leads to the phenotype. Phenotype is something you can study. Genotype is sort of the reason why you get that particular phenotype. A genetic screen, and this is a really important aspect, probably much more so in the classical genetic sense or the forward genetic sense. That is where you just look for mutants with a particular phenotype. So you know the phenotype you're looking for, and you're trying to find a particular mutant which has that particular phenotype. This is a classic way that's used in what's called forward genetics. You have a phenotype, and you're trying to find the mutant which gives you that phenotype, and then isolate the gene which leads to that particular phenotype. On the other hand, what's happening more and more these days, because DNA sequencing is a lot easier, protein sequencing is a lot easier, you have a lot of proteomics, is what people are now calling reverse genetics, and basically it's just flipping forward genetics on its head. You start out with the gene, and then you try and figure out what the phenotype is. And to do that, you basically have to break something. Again, as mentioned before, what do geneticists do? They break things. Well, in this case, they're breaking that particular gene, altering the gene, and then trying to find out what that phenotype is. That's shown here in a more graphical form from your textbook, where the green arrows are sort of forward genetics. You have a particular mutant organism, mutant cell, where you have wild type and your mutant. This is now what you start with. You want to know what the reason is for that particular mutant phenotype. Usually do genetic analysis. Very often this will be screening of a DNA library. You find then the particular gene which you think is responsible for that phenotype, and then you study that gene in more detail, down here at the bottom, usually in terms of the protein or if it's a functional RNA, which you're looking for the functional RNA. On the other hand, reverse genetics, over here with the orange lines and orange arrows, you start out with a protein or a gene, then you determine what its sequence is, and then you make a specific change in that gene in order to inactivate it to try and find out what the function of that particular gene is. So, that being said, for genetics, reverse genetics, almost all the time that you'll be working with these particular genes and genotypes, you'll be talking about dominant and recessive mutants. Now, all that that really means is that we're mostly talking about a diploid organism, so a diploid organism having two copies of the chromosomes, any given chromosome, sister chromatids. This would be paternal and maternal, or one parent and the other parent. In this case, light blue is the wild type, diploid genotype, two wild types. This is going to be the most common case, and when you see, it's wild type. On the other hand, if you now have a dominant mutation, it doesn't matter if you have one copy, either your maternal or paternal, or both of them, you end up with a mutant phenotype. On the other hand, with a recessive, and these are much more common kinds of mutations, when you have a one copy of your recessive, one copy of the wild type, your phenotype is wild type, and you only actually see a mutant phenotype when you have two copies of this recessive allele or the recessive mutants that you're actually looking for. This brings me to the reminder, again, hopefully review for all of you, mitosis and meiosis. Normal cell division is the mitotic cell division, where you start out with two copies again. This is for diploid organisms, paternal and maternal chromosomes. You undergo DNA replication. Each of those ends up with two copies. Normal mitotic division. Each of those identical copies of the two sister chromatids of each other get copied, divided, and each of the daughter cells end up with the same copies that you had up here at the beginning. And again, they have all have two copies as diploid organisms, paternal and maternal copies. On the other hand, in meiosis, which is, you know, where you're dividing before you're going to usually undergo sexual reproduction, you go from a diploid, where you have paternal and maternal, to down the bottom, where you have haploid genomes. So again, same replication happens at the beginning. You have the chromatids which come together, but now instead of maternal and paternal chromatids getting separated relative to each other, first thing you have is crossing over, which takes place. This is where these two chromatids, the sister chromatids, line up with each other. You have crossing over. That crossing over takes place with a mechanism extremely similar to homologous recombination that we talked about in the last lecture. Once you've had this homologous recombination, you note that the little pieces of genomes often get exchanged, and then each of these paternal and maternal chromosomes, or so to say chromatids, get separated from each other, and you end up with now haploid cells at the end. These would normally be your sex cells, so in case of here we'd have sperm and egg cells, for instance, and mammalian cells. Each of these has a single copy of the genome, which can now be separate from each other. So why is this so important? Well, this is really important for looking at individual mutants and how these mutants undergo segregation through this meiosis process. So now if you start out with a dominant mutation, and that's shown here as two big A alleles relative to the wild type alleles, which are small a's here. You have the mutant father, wild type mother, or vice versa, doesn't really matter. In the gametes, again, these are after you've had your meiosis. All four of these are going to be A's, the mutant, large A. All four of these over here are going to be wild type, small a's. The first generation, or the F1 generation, after these two parents have mated, generate now a heterozygous genotype, but a mutant phenotype, because this is the dominant mutant here. Then these organisms generate gametes. When you now take these and would then mate them with themselves, you end up with a combination of dominant mutants, recessive wild type, dominant mutant, recessive wild type. And in this case, your F2 generation, where these two have been bred with each other, two copies of these guys, you'll end up with three mutant phenotypes and one normal phenotype. So this is your classic what would happen if you have a dominant allele that gets passed along. Exactly the same thing happens if wild type is dominant relative to the mutant. So now a mutant is a recessive allele. You have wild type here, big B, heterozygote, wild type phenotype, because wild type is dominant in this case. However, when you have an F2 generation, then you can regenerate your mutants because, again, these guys have separated from each other. So this is just a way to, with diploid organisms, see whether you have dominant mutations or recessive mutations. Yeast are really wonderful model organisms, and we talked about these a little bit before, right back at the beginning of the class, because they've got relatively small genomes. They replicate really easily on petri plates. You can get lots and lots of them. They're relatively easy to get mutants. But one of the really neat things about yeasts, and this is true mostly for Saccharomyces cerevisiae, but there are a number of other yeast species as well that this works for, and that is that they can function perfectly normally, make cells as a haploid type, i.e. just having one copy of their genome as opposed to two, but they can also replicate as diploids. And so you can take two different haploid yeast strains, and as long as they're opposite mating types, and we don't have time to talk about how you get opposite mating types, but opposite mating types like male and female equivalent, so A and alpha in the case of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, these haploids can mate with each other. You end up with a diploid cell, and just like we had with the diploids in the last slide, this is going to show whatever the dominant phenotype is. In this case, wild type is dominant. And then this undergoes meiosis, and meiosis in yeast cells is sporulation. And you end up with four separate spores. And if you look at these spores, you can actually screen these spores. There'll be four of them, and this is what they look like over here. Just look at each of these spores separately, and what you'll find is it doesn't matter. Each of these represent four spores. This would be one, two, three, four. Each of the rows here are different spores. And if you look in each case, each of them, two of them are going to be wild type and two of them are going to be mutant. And that's, you know, classic segregation that you get for these kind of yeast mutants. And so it's really nice to have these kinds of organisms that you can replicate both as haploids and as diploids. And so we'll see this as we move along a little bit more through some of these examples here. And particularly important here are the so-called conditional lethal mutants. And the reason that lethal mutants are so useful is that, you know, these are now going to be genes that are absolutely critical for life as we know it, and in the case of yeast, but yeast is a nice model organism, so if a gene is critical in yeast, then you can have a pretty good idea that's likely to be lethal and are very important for function in lots of other organisms. So when I say a lethal mutant, that means in wild type you absolutely need it, and if you have a mutant, then that organism happens to be dead. Well, we talked about before, you know, to actually study genetics, you have to study phenotypes. Well, death is a really hard phenotype to study because you kind of need something to be alive to be able to study it. So basically what you have to have are what are called conditional lethal mutants. And so those conditional lethal mutants are such that under some conditions, they actually function just fine. and under other conditions they don't. And probably the most common of these conditional lethal mutants are the so-called temperature-sensitive mutants. And so what that means is, at a lower temperature, or a permissive temperature, these mutants grow just fine. But when you raise the temperature, you find that these mutants actually no longer grow. And so what that gives you is a really nice indication that whatever gene it was that was mutated now is actually absolutely critical for function. And because you can get these cells to grow at the permissive temperature, you can go back and actually analyze the gene that's given you that particular mutation. So let's look at an example here. This is yeast, regular happy yeast growing in liquid culture. You add a mutagen, or you somehow mutagenize these cells, put them into lots of different smaller amounts of cells. Presumably each of these now has one particular mutant in them, or one particular mutation that's taken place. And now you take one of these aliquots, you now separate each of the individual cells, each of those will grow up into an individual colony. You do all of this now at the permissive temperature, so that they grow just fine. And then you take a copy of all of these colonies and look and see which of these can now grow at 23 degrees, but not at the higher temperature. So now you can go back and analyze this particular colony, because this will have arisen from one particular cell, which has a issue with growth at 36 degrees. So it'll be a conditional lethal mutation. Probably the most famous of these conditional lethals, or the temperature-sensitive lethal mutations, are the so-called CDC mutants. We already talked about some of these CDC mutants when we talked about DNA replication. They stand for cell division cycle, and those cell division cycle mutants show that you have a difference between the wild type or a couple of different CDC mutants. This is, you know, 28 and 7, they just found a whole bunch of them. And what you can see now is these cells, they're growing now wild type at now the high temperature, the non-permissive temperature. These guys grow perfectly happily, they make little buds, these buds bud off, they make sister cells. Here, however, we have a case where the cells don't bud anymore. These are the CDC28 mutants. CDC7, you have budding which takes place, but these cells don't actually separate from each other. And it turns out that almost all of these cell division cycle mutants are really critical for, you know, not surprisingly, the cell cycle. And if you look at the cell cycle in humans, mammalian cells, it turns out to have homologs of almost all of these mutants, which were originally found in Saccharomyces cerevisiae by Lee Hartwell, in parallel in Schizosaccharomyces pombi by Paul Nurse. Both of those guys shared the Nobel Prize for understanding the cell cycle, and it turns out these are really critical for cancer cells and how cancer cells replicate as well. So those are how you can look at particular mutations, which are now conditional lethals. But now another question that came up really pretty quickly is, well, is it just one gene where you're getting these conditional lethal mutations, or is it potentially multiple genes that you're looking at? Because all that Lee Hartwell and his colleagues and Paul Nurse and their colleagues had found were these were mutations which were conditionally lethal, but they didn't know if they were different genes. They could guess they were different genes. Again, if you looked at that last slide, we could see that, you know, some cells had problems with budding and other cells had problems with actually separating the two cells once they had undergone replication. So another way, and this is also what Hartwell and Nurse did in their particular groups, was to now look at whether these were single genes or multiple genes. And the way you can do that is actually really easy in yeast. And this is what's called the complementation analysis. And basically, all that you're looking at is taking two different kinds of mutants. Now, you've isolated, say this would be CDC28, CDC7, and One of them is now going to be in your haploid with an A type. One will be at a haploid in an alpha type. You take these two, you make a diploid, you grow them at the permissive temperature, which again is 23 degrees Celsius, and then screen to see if they'll grow at the non-permissive temperature. If these two mutants are in different genes, and they're both recessive, you'll end up with wild-type growth here, even though you have two particular mutants. And that's because in this diploid organism, you have a wild-type copy of each of those particular genes. If, on the other hand, you have these two mutations that are in the same gene, you find that they grow fine at the permissive temperature because they're TS mutants, but they won't grow at the non-permissive temperature. And what that tells you is that these two mutations are probably in the same gene because they don't now have a wild-type copy that you can complement from. This is only one of the explanations, but it's the most common explanation for them. So one thing that I wanted to remind you of is almost all of these mutations are going to be loss-of-function alleles, and loss-of-function then is classic when you make a mutation, and the question we're trying to answer here are these two mutations in the same genes or not? Another thing that you can do with double mutant analysis is look at both biosynthetic pathways and signaling pathways. And again, it's looking at what kinds of phenotypes you get when you generate double mutants. Again, first we just looked at complementation. That was two mutations in the same gene or in different genes. But now what you can look at are biosynthetic pathways, also by looking at double mutants. And again, double mutant, you take two haploids, you put them together, and then you end up with a diploid that has these two mutants in it. You can either then make those two mutants as a homozygote, which is what you may need to get a recessive phenotype, or you may have dominant mutations, which you, of course, don't need to have a homozygote to find that. So here, looking at biosynthetic pathway, if you have a mutation in gene A, you end up with intermediate number one, and it doesn't matter whether you have a mutation in gene B or not, because you can't make this particular reaction. If you have a mutation in B, then you end up with two, because A is functioning here. You end up with, and these are usually enzymatic reactions, you end up with a lot of two and you never end up with three. And if you have a mutation in A and B, you end up with one. And so the neat thing here is it actually allows you to order these two reactions. So you can measure one, you can measure two, and measure three. In a double mutant, you've got of A and B, you have just one. In a single mutant of B, you have two. In a single mutant of A, you have one. And that means that B comes after A. And very similar things you can find if you're looking at a signaling pathway. In the case of two regulators of gene expression, and we'll talk about regulation of gene expression much more detail in the next lecture. If we have two mutations, again, A and B, that gives you less expression of your gene. However, if you have a mutation in B that gives you more expression of your gene, that tells you that A is positively regulating your gene and B is negatively regulating A. On the other hand, if you have mutations in A and B which give you good expression, that means that both of these are acting in a negative fashion. And we'll talk much more about this when we talk about reporter genes and gene regulation, particularly later on in the course. But double mutants, again, look at complementation. Can we see them in the same gene? If you can analyze intermediates of some kind of enzymatic pathway, it tells you the order of particular genes in that pathway. For signaling pathways, it tells you which gene is regulating which other gene, particularly in terms of looking at that. So now I'd like to switch gears a little bit and talk about how you determine where genes are relative to each other on particular chromosomes. And this was a really classic method that was used for decades in genetic analysis. Now it's changing a little bit because we have genome sequences. But basically what this was looking at how often particular different genes now ended up being associated with each other or not associated with. They're also what's called linked to each other. And we now know that that has to do with how close these particular genes happen to be on a chromosome. And the reason for that is when you have crossing over that takes place in meiosis, you remember we talked about meiosis before, when you have crossing over that takes place, now you can have exchange of alleles between one pair of chromosomes and another pair of chromosomes. And in that process, you end up with these recombinant, i.e., these are not what you started out with, parental gametes down here at the bottom. And so we'll look at here, this particular one, M1 was parental, but didn't have M2. Here, now you've got one that doesn't have a mutation at all, because it's picked up the wild-type version from the red chromosome and transferred it on the blue chromosome. Here, the opposite case, you've now got the two mutations that you've picked up. You picked up mutation 1 from blue and put it onto the chromosome with mutation 2. And then you have the parental genome here, chromosome, which had the single mutation on it. How do you actually study this? That's what is shown over here on the right-hand side, where we have our heterozygote allele. So now we've got this, the line here just represents the two parental chromatids, big A, little b, little a, big b. And so now you have this heterozygote strain. Now to test this to see how close A and B are relative to each other, you now cross this with, and crossing just means mating to, an organism which has the mutant, or it doesn't really matter, as long as this is homozygotic for both of these two markers. So now, if you get back out from your cross, these big A, little b, or big A, big b, relative to, in this case, is your recessive phenotype, so you should always see, you know, your B's and A's as small b's together with big A's, small a's together with big B's. If you see any types, you've got big A, big B, little a, little b, so the two dominants together and the two recessives together, again, these are separate organisms, now you know that you've gotten recombination that's taken place. Now, how frequently do you get recombination? That you can just literally count the number of parental offspring, parental genotypes and phenotypes here, versus the recombinant phenotypes that you get over here. And it turns out that the distance between the two mutations that you're talking about, the two alleles, so M1 and M2 in this particular case, the closer they are together, the less frequently you're going to get recombination that happens between them. Because crossing over happens in all synapses, if these two genes are very close to each other, it's unlikely you're going to get crossing over that happens. If they're further apart, they're much more likely to have crossing over that happens between the two of them. And so you can calculate the genetic distance between these two, just looking at the number of recombinants divided by the total number of gametes. And this is usually done in centimorgans, so the genetic unit for looking at this. If you have closely linked genes, this is going to be a very small number. If you have unlinked genes, this is going to be 100. So that's it for classical genetics, I'd like to spend about the next half hour talking about molecular cloning, which is now much more thinking about that reverse genetic process. You have a particular gene, a particular protein. Now you want to go back and look at the phenotype, or you happen to have now gotten this particular phenotype. You found where this gene is. It's giving you that particular phenotype that you were looking for in your normal forward genetic screen. Now what you'd like to do is actually analyze that particular gene. So, probably the most important tool, with the possible exception of the polymerase chain reaction, are these endonucleases that are called restriction endonucleases. The reason they're called restriction endonucleases is because they would actually restrict how viruses could infect bacteria. And the reason for that is that these endonucleases would cut in the middle of bacterial virus genomes, and in doing so, break them up into smaller pieces, and so the virus couldn't replicate anymore. And so this particular case, no, office hours are canceled today, I'm not going to be in. So here, ECHO-R1 comes from E. coli, it's just the R1 endonuclease, and remember again, endonucleases, endo means it cuts in the middle of a piece of DNA, exos are cutting in from the ends. ECHO-R1 cuts in the middle of DNA, and in this particular case, it binds to a particular sequence in the DNA, which is 5'GAATTC. It's a palindromic site, which means the sequence on the opposite strand is identical, but going in the opposite direction again, 5'GAATTC. ECHO-R1 binds, cuts here, and one of the great things about ECHO-R1 is when it cuts, it leaves these so-called sticky ends. And so these are, in this case, a 5' overhang with AATT, which is single-stranded. It does that the same now for the opposite strand on the other side. There are literally hundreds, probably almost getting to 1,000, different restriction endonucleases that have been found in various different microorganisms, almost all of them bacteria. And that's just a table here from your textbook. BAMH1, Bacillus amyloliquefaciens, SAL3A, Staphylococcus aureus, ECHO-R1, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All of these guys cut at different restriction sites. Almost all of them have this symmetry to them. One strand, 5' to 3' is the same as the one on the opposite strand. However, they don't always bind to exactly the same sequence. And this is a nice example here between BAMH1 and SAL3A1. You ignore the typo in the textbook here. So this BAMH1 binds to GGATCC, and SAL3A binds to GATC. Well, when GATC, it doesn't matter what the sequences are out here, but it's still going to give you a GATC sticky end. Well, BAMH1 gives you a GATC sticky end. And so you can cut something with SAL3A1, and then have it bind to and stick to things that have been cut with BAMH1. Just really briefly here at the bottom, you don't have to have these overhangs, some of these restriction endonucleases cut so there's no overhangs, and some of these restriction endonucleases actually cut much longer sequences. This particular one, not one, cuts an 8-base sequence. Why are these things so useful? Well, if you now have sticky ends at the end of your particular piece of DNA that you want to put together, now this sticky end is only going to interact with things that have been cut with either the same restriction endonuclease or one which gives you the same sticky ends. So in this case, TTAA, actually it should be AATT going from 5' to 3', is going to bind to AATT. So it's only going to bind to this fragment here and not these other fragments together. So two pieces, you put them together. Now you've got these ends which can base pair to each other. If you put this together with a DNA ligase, most people use a bacteriophage DNA ligase, but you don't have to. Any DNA ligase will do. Now these things get hooked up together, and so you've taken this piece of DNA and hooked it up to that piece of DNA. Now, this can be any DNA that you're looking at, and so this is really the beginnings of what people called recombinant DNA. So you can have DNA from one source, DNA from another source, and then just literally put the two of them together. So this is recombinant DNA, two DNAs from different sources. All cellular organisms use DNA as a genetic material. So you can take DNA from one, say a pig, put it together with DNA from a plant. Usually it's eukaryotic, particularly human DNA that you put into bacteria. They're all using DNA as a genetic material. So all of them, you can do that with every single one of them. One of the most useful things that you can use for that is what's called these cloning vectors. And these are usually small circular pieces of DNA that were originally found in bacteria, which have a resistance to some kind of antibiotic. And that's really important for knowing that we have actually gotten this particular piece of DNA into, usually, again, our bacterium. An origin of replication, so that this piece of DNA can make more of itself, or it gets all of the DNA replication machinery to bind to it and make more of it. And then this particular region, very often called the polylinker or stuffer or spacer region in this plasmid, which very often will have multiple different binding and cutting sites for lots of different restriction endonucleases. So HindI3, PSD1, SAL1, we already talked about BAMH1, we talked about ECHOR1. So each of these multiple sequences will be in here. Then you treat this plasmid with a restriction endonuclease, you treat your DNA with a restriction endonuclease, and then you can ligate the two of them together. And then once you put the two of them together, the critical thing is you can now replicate this in a particular bacterium. So let's look at that right now. Here's the process. This is really basically for making lots of copies of one particular piece of DNA. Here's our DNA fragment that you want many copies of, also known as molecular cloning. You take this, you put it into a plasmid vector. Again, usually this is going to be derived from a bacterial plasmid. It'll be, you cut this with a restriction endonuclease, you cut this with a restriction endonuclease, you ligate the two of them together, and then you take this piece of DNA and put it into E. coli. Really critically here now is that we have this antibiotic resistance gene which is in here. So you treat all of these bacterial cells with antibiotic. Only the one which has picked up this plasmid can replicate. This E. coli replicates. It replicates many copies of this plasmid, and so you end up with lots and lots of copies of this plasmid in the particular E. coli. You can now separate this plasmid from the E. coli, basically based on its size, and then you have many copies of your, and very often I'll call this your favorite gene, it's this small purple piece, many, many copies of that particular gene. So this is useful if you happen to know what gene it is that you're looking for, but very often what you want to have are copies of as much of a particular genome as possible in these plasmids, because it's really easy to work with E. coli, it's really a pain in the neck to work with humans, and so it's nice to have as many different human genes as you can in E. coli, and so you can study them there reasonably easily. Another really useful thing to have are what are called cDNAs. And so cDNA, the C here just stands for complementary DNA, and that's complementary DNA to an RNA. So unfortunately, didn't have a chance to talk about retroviruses before, but basically this takes advantage of some of the particular enzymes that you find in retroviruses, particularly RNA-dependent DNA polymerases, also known as reverse transcriptases. So reverse transcriptases are DNA polymerases that can use RNA templates. And what's really nice now is you can take messenger RNAs that you've isolated from one particular cell, one particular organism, one particular place and time. You can now take these messenger RNAs and then include a poly-T primer. Now, why are poly-T primers so useful? That's because messenger RNAs all have these 3' poly-A tails. If you have a oligo-T primer, that can bind to the poly-A tail of your messenger RNA. Now has a 3' OH at the end here. Your reverse transcriptase can extend this to the end of your messenger RNA. Now you get rid of this RNA. You can either, in this case, it's getting rid of with alkali. You can also use RNase H. Once you've done this, now you have a DNA copy with just your messenger RNA right next to it with a poly-T tail on it. So this is the complement of that messenger RNA you started with. You can now add a poly-G tail. Actually, you can add any tail you like to the end of this. Usually use a ligase or sometimes a polymerase. This can now serve as a template for a new primer you put in. You make that second strand, and now you have a double-stranded copy of that messenger RNA you started with up at the top here. You can, in this case, either take this fragment, put it into a vector directly, but very often what people will do is they'll put what the so-called linkers onto this DNA, and this particular linker has an EcoR1 site in it. This EcoR1 site you can link to the end again through DNA ligase processes. Now you have a piece of DNA that has a EcoR1 site at either end. Now you can cut this with EcoR1. You end up with sticky ends. You have a plasmid that has these sticky ends as well. You put these two together. Now you have individual clones. These are all going to have come from one particular E. coli that has that particular plasmid vector in it. This is great. But what if you have any GAATTCs in this messenger RNA up here at the top that you started with? Well, if you now cut with EcoR1 down here, you're going to chop up this piece of DNA and you'll end up with only part of your messenger RNA in the first place. So the trick to deal with that is back up here at step six, which I skipped, some of you may have noticed. And that is that now what you do is you methylate your DNA, and particularly this is your DNA that came from the messenger RNA at the beginning, with a very specific methylase that now methylates the DNA at GAATTC. And so now you've methylated the DNA there, and that actually, as it turns out, is exactly the way that the E. coli protects its DNA from getting cleaved by the EcoR1 restriction endonuclease. So basically, what you're doing now is pretending that this is E. coli DNA. When you treat with the EcoR1 restriction endonuclease, it's chopping up what it thinks would be viral DNA. So again, put these two guys together, ligate them to the plasmid. You get lots and lots of individual clones, and hopefully each of these individual clones is going to represent a different messenger RNA up here. And that's what's meant by the library. And so the library is hopefully every different one of the messenger RNAs that you started with up the top is going to be represented in each of these individual spots down here at the bottom. Now, this is great and wonderful, but which of these are the ones that you want? Which one has that messenger RNA in it that is the gene of interest, what you're actually looking for? Well, one way to figure this out is what's called library screening, or what's also called a colony lift assay. The way that you do these assays is you have an E. coli plate with all these colonies on it, and again, each of these hopefully represents a different messenger RNA, if we're talking about our cDNA library. What you do is you put a filter or just basically some way of picking up a little bit of each of these E. coli colonies on here, which is going to be hundreds and millions of cells. You now take this filter off and then break open these cells and allow the DNA to be hybridized to by your labeled, and in this case, this is your red labeled DNA. Usually, this would be a radioactive probe, it might not be, but radioactivity is sort of the classic way to do this. So now, in this particular colony, you're going to have lots of different DNAs. They incubate them together with a labeled DNA. That now is going to base pair to this particular, in this case, messenger RNA that has now been made into a cDNA copy that you're looking for. And it's usually easy to find a really small piece of your DNA, and very often what you're trying to do is find the messenger RNA that corresponds to a gene which you may have found. And as we talked about before, and we'll talk about much more later on, often this will be a splicing product. And so you're trying to find out what the sequence is of the messenger RNA after it's been spliced out of a particular gene. And so here you find that, okay, we know one particular piece, say this is the first part of your gene, it hybridizes now. Here you've hybridized to all of these particular pieces, but you care about what the rest of this sequence is. None of the other spots on here will have hybridized to your labeled DNA at all. And you find one spot on your nitrocellulose filter. Now you can go back up to the beginning here and pull off this colony right here, because this colony has plasmid in it, which contains your cDNA sequence, which you can now go ahead and get the DNA sequence from. One other way of doing this is now, instead of using E. coli, you can use yeast DNA. And so this is a case of how you can use a yeast library. This particular experiment uses a really neat kind of vector, which can actually replicate both in E. coli and in Saccharomyces cerevisiae. So the ori over here in your plasmid, this means you can replicate in E. coli. The ampicillin resistance is a antibiotic resistance, so that any E. coli cells that have this plasmid in them will be resistant to ampicillin. But then here you also have a centromere sequence that we'll talk about more when we talk about chromosome structure, an autonomous replication sequence. This is now a yeast origin of replication, and then a URA3 selectable marker gene that we'll talk about in just a second here, which allows you to select for yeast cells which have this particular plasmid in them as well. You've got a polylinker, you use this polylinker now to clone in your favorite gene. So now if we have our vector, we cut it with our favorite restriction endonuclease, in this case it's BAMH1. We take our yeast genomic DNA, so it's genomic DNA that we've now cut with SOUTH3A1. Remember, SOUTH3A1 generates sticky ends that are compatible with the BAMH1, so the sticky ends here are the same. You can put these guys together. You now have a library in E. coli once you've transformed for it, and now you have ampicillin resistance. Now, the next step, and this is what's allowed because we have this shuttle vector that also works in yeast, now we can assay this for what's called functional complementation. And that's shown here. So now again, we've got our temperature-sensitive CDC mutant yeast. So this can grow at 23 degrees, which is the permissive temperature, but it can't grow at the higher temperature. This particular mutant also has a secondary mutation in it, which is the URA3. Doesn't really matter, but basically here, this is a mutation which means that you have to feed these cells uracil. Now, you take your library of various different yeast genomic DNAs. Now remember, these are from a wild type yeast. These also have the URA3 marker in them. You take this yeast, you transform it, you put all these plasmids individually into those yeast cells, and then you look for these cells which now can grow in the absence of uracil. And that they can grow in the absence of uracil means that they've picked up this plasmid gene here, which means they've been transformed. Now they've got all of these various different genomic DNAs here. They're growing still at 23 degrees, so you're not looking for whatever complementation here. First, you're just looking for transformation. But now you do the replica plating test, which we talked about before, and then check these guys to see which ones can grow now under the non-permissive temperature conditions. And the only ones which can grow here now are the ones which now have complemented your CDC mutant. Now you can purify the DNAs from each of these colonies here, but also here because they're growing just fine. These are going to be the plasmid DNAs which have now complemented your CDC mutant. And so now you can determine the sequence of that particular mutant complementing DNA. So again, these were all genomic clones from a wild type DNA that have now complemented this CDC mutant. If you pull out that particular plasmid that has complemented the CDC mutant, that's going to be your wild type CDC gene. And so you can characterize that and study it later on. Finish up with today's lecture. I want to just really briefly talk about agarose gel electrophoresis and detection of different DNAs through this process. Again, hopefully this is review for you. Usually, and again, people in my lab will tell you all about this, you have lots of different sized pieces of DNA that you've made usually by cutting them by restriction endonucleases. You put these onto either an agarose or a polyacrylamide gel, not at all dissimilar from SDS Page, except we're just treating these in buffer right now. You separate these now based on size, and the reason you can do that based on size, because you think about the DNA molecule, it has uniform negative charge along it because of all the phosphates. And so here, even though you're separating in an electric field, you're basically just separating based on size. Here, the smaller molecules go through this gel faster than the larger molecules, and you can see these separating from each other. And this is just an example up here on the upper right-hand side, where we have individual pieces of DNA, many of them cut with restriction endonucleases. These are probably plasmids that have been cut with restriction endonucleases. And they migrate from largest here at the top to smallest down here at the bottom. And usually, when you do these experiments, you take a mixture of DNA where you know the sizes of these individual pieces, and that's shown here on the right and probably the left-hand side as well of your gel. So now you have these bands on your gel. Now, how do you detect them? There are really two different ways of doing this. One, as they have here, is autoradiography, and that is if you have all of your fragments here that are labeled with a particular radioisotope. And so you can use just photographic film. Much more commonly, people will use a fluorescent dye, particularly something like ethidium bromide, which, when you shine UV light on it, will emit in the visible. And so binding to each of these DNA fragments will give you a fluorescent band. Now, seeing all of these bands is really useful, but usually you want to detect individual ones, and that's the case for southern blots and northern blots, which we'll talk about on Wednesday's lecture. But the last thing that I wanted to talk about today, and again, hopefully this is all review for you, this is the other process, which above and beyond the restriction endonucleases, and often they use together, which has really revolutionized molecular biology. Something called the polymerase chain reaction. Everyone calls it PCR. And it's really an incredibly straightforward process. Kerry Mullis got the Nobel Prize for coming up with this. Kerry Mullis is kind of a crazy guy. If you want to see the most bizarre Nobel laureate speech, at least the one most bizarre that I know of, go to the Nobel Prize website and listen to, or at least read his speech. It's very bizarre. His animal rights activists may have been high when he came up with this idea, who knows. But nonetheless, this again completely revolutionized molecular biology and forensics and, you know, all kinds of other things as well. So what I wanted to mention here, and again, hopefully this is a review, the way that PCR works is you take double-stranded DNA, you pull the two strands apart. Basically, this is a denaturation process. You usually do this by raising the temperature. Then you lower the temperature, so you get primers, which are added to this particular DNA. And probably one of the things that made this process possible was actually DNA synthesis and being able to make DNAs of specific sequence really well. Don't have time to get into that, but it's a really amazing breakthrough in terms of being able to do any of these things. So put together your primers of known sequence. Now these have three prime OHs at the end of them. You now have a DNA polymerase, which will elongate from each of these primers. Then you do exactly the same thing again. You pull the two strands apart, you put in new primers, you have extension, and so on and so forth, and you continue with this process usually through about 30 cycles, and you end up with many, many copies of the piece of DNA which is between these two primers. Now, one thing to bear in mind is that at least in the first couple of cycles, you actually are going to be elongating past where this other primer is. So you'll notice here, even down here, after four cycles, you still have many copies of your DNA that you've amplified, which is longer than any of these individual primers. What you're really looking for are these pieces here, which are just between your two primers. And if you go through this process, and I have an animation of this online on D2L you can take a look at, you'll end up getting a exponential amplification of these pieces of DNA that are just between these two primers, but you'll still have some of these that are a little bit longer at the end here. So that's the polymerase chain reaction. Last thing to talk about today is how you put polymerase chain reaction together with restriction endonucleases, and that is you start out here with your piece of DNA that you want to amplify that has specific sequences at either end. You now use primers that have sequences which are complementary to the piece you want to amplify here for normal PCR, but you hang on a restriction endonuclease site onto that primer. And so now you amplify your DNA here, and so it has an amplified DNA with this tag at the end. The primer you use in the opposite direction is the same, also has a restriction endonuclease binding and recognition site at the other end. You now amplify a piece of DNA that also has these restriction endonuclease sites at either end. Now you can cut with those restriction endonuclease sites and put them into your plasmid, which can, of course, now replicate in E. coli, and use this now to make many copies of your individual gene. So we'll stop here. We'll continue with talking about how to analyze your cloned DNA, and again, molecularly cloned DNA, in lecture on Wednesday. Hope that you all survived the late start today, and we'll see you all on Wednesday.